Let's go back to schematic and let's have a look on the next page. BMC power, decoupling capacitors, BMC straps, we were speaking about straps, BMC Ethernet, and something new is starting. CPLD JTAG header, and the next page is CPLD. As I mentioned before, there are many different signals which you may want to combine together, and that's how this CPLD is used. Otherwise, you would need many gates. So CPLD makes the design much easier and much more simple. But we don't really need to spend much time on this CPLD. As I said, these are just some kind of combined signals. Decoupling of the CPLD and port 80. I'm not sure if you know what exactly port 80 is and how it is used, but you know, when you, for example, try to switch on your PC and nothing happens, there is a problem, then this port 80 can help you to identify what exactly the problem is, or at least where the board where your PC stopped booting. Port 80 is actually the way how BIOS can send you some messages. These messages are called postcodes, and these postcodes are sent on the port 80 where you can read them. If you would like to know more, you can just search for postcodes. This is, for example, an Intel postcode webpage. And when I'm designing x86 boards, I use this kind of board, not exactly this one, but it has display. And then when the board stops booting, you can read the number, which is here, and based on some documentation and based on the number, you can identify where exactly it stopped. Yeah, for example, here you can see if the number starts with 2, then it means it was doing memory initialization, initializing chipset component, reading SPD, detecting presence of memory. And if it stops somewhere here, then it means, for example, there is something wrong with the memory. And this documentation, it may be different between different BIOSes, so you would need to find your specific postcodes for your BIOS. Let's go back to our schematic, and the next page is hot swap circuit. I think this is the main input power, what we can see here. The next page is nothing really important, and PCI Express slot. Let's have a look how this PCI Express is routed. When we go to layout, there are a number of PCI Express interfaces. I only highlighted some of the PCI Express signals. I use this yellow color to highlight or to show the signals which are connected, PCI Express signals which are connected between this processor 0 to this PCI Express slot, which is here. What is interesting to see, notice, same as for the SATA signals, all these PCI Express signals, they are routed on one layer together. All the signals are routed together on one layer. On this top layer, there are all the TX signals. Notice, yeah, okay, TX signal, TX, TX, TX. All the RX signals are routed on the bottom layer. Again, together, these are all the RX signals routed between the processor and the slot. We were speaking about the routing differential pairs when we were speaking about the SATA interface. We already know that under this BGA there is a little bit different clearance, little bit different track thickness. We were also speaking about these bumps to compensate the length difference between the negative and positive signal. But what I would like to mention when we are speaking about these PCI Express signals is how they are routed. I'm pretty sure you noticed how these, how some of the signals on these boards are routed quite weird way. And I think the most visible place where it looks really, really weird is this place between the on the connections between the processors. And when I zoom in, you will notice that these signals, they are not routed straight. They are routed zigzag. Do you know why is this? Why they do it this way? Why they don't just draw the straight signal? Straight line, straight track. There is a very nice document on internet. You can search for this document or just go on this URL, which is here. Then find this chapter, what is fiber wave effect? And here is a nice picture, which will show you how PCB looks. Yeah, PCB is built based on this fiberglass. And when you are basically routing very high speed signals, that it may really make difference if one of the signals of this differential pair is routed above the fiberglass or if it's routed between the fiberglass. You can read it here, okay? Because the dielectric constant will be different and it may influence the quality of the signal. And that's why they recommend to route it something like this. And that's what is very nice visible on this board. The other thing what I would like to mention when we are speaking about these PCI Express signals is that there is this through-hole connector on the PCI Express. And some people, they wonder if they connect this slot on the top layer, and because there are these through-hole pins, then in these places here, basically there will be stub. Because, you know, the signal goes on the top layer and then it goes up to the slot. But on the bottom, there is this pin. So there is the stub on this signal. And some people, they wonder if there will be no problem. You can see they do it this way, yeah? And no problem. I also route the PCI Express signal same way. I use the through-hole connectors and some signals are routed on the top, some are on the bottom, and it works just fine. So that's what I wanted to point out on these PCI Express interfaces. Okay, there is another really interesting thing what we can have a look at on this board, and these are stitching vias. Do you know stitching vias? Do you know how they are used and why we use them? I'm going to explain. When I zoom in, this is the example of the routing with stitching vias. Basically, when you are routing very important signals, for example, high-speed signals, then when these signals are changing layers, the way that they will also change the reference plane, you need to use stitching vias. Have a look, okay? Here in this example, we can see SATA signals, so high-speed signals. They are routed on the top layer, and the reference plane, the plane where the return currents for these signals will flow, is the layer 2. This is a solid ground plane. This is the reference plane for these SATA signals. However, because we are changing the layers the way that these signals, they continue on layer 6, you can see it here, they continue on layer 6, it means this layer 2 ground is not going to be reference plane for these signals routed on layer 6 anymore, okay? The reference plane is not going to be layer 2, but it's going to be layer 7 instead. This is going to be reference plane for these signals routed on layer 6. And because we are changing these reference planes, we need to use stitching vias. That's exactly what you can see here. So stitching vias are basically the vias which are connected to ground, and these vias, they connect these layer 2 and layer 7 together in the place where these vias for the SATA signals are placed. So you need to place the stitching vias close to these vias of the signals, so the return currents can flow through these vias as close as possible to the place where the signals are changing the layers. If we have a look on different situation, let's say we are changing the layers only between top and L3, what do you think? Do we need to use the stitching vias? I'm going to find the example. It's here. So these are PCI Express signals. And you can see they are changing layer here and there are no stitching vias. And it's because the reference plane for these signals is the layer 2 ground plane. And because they continue on layer 3, we don't need to place here stitching vias, because this plane on layer 2 still is the reference plane for these signals which are routed on layer 3. Very nice example. And when we are speaking about these ground planes, I would like to show you something else. When I zoom in on these mini SAS connectors, and when I enable the layer 2, notice these holes under the connector pads, and notice these holes around the vias on the SATA signals. There are also holes in this ground plane under the pads of these resistors and capacitors, which are placed on the SATA signals. Okay, this is the schematic of the mini SAS, and there are some resistors and capacitors. That's exactly what you can see here in this area. You create these holes in the ground plane because that's what is recommended for routing really high-speed signals. If you, for example, search for this kind of document, design guidelines for 100 gigabits per second interface, you will see there something like this. Host connector layout optimization reduces the impact of discontinuity at the differential pair to the connector interface. A reference plane cutout is provided beneath the connector pads, and larger oval antipads are used for the signal vias. Four nearby ground return vias, so stitching vias, are provided to help reduce the connector interface discontinuity. If we go down here, that's exactly what you can see on the server PCB. Yeah? When we have a look here, the ground holes, or the holes in the ground plane under the pads, under the pads of the connector, under the pads of these resistors and capacitors, and big hole around these vias. Exactly what is here in this document. Again, if you like, just search for this, okay? Design guidelines for 100 gigabit per second interface. I will disable the top layer so you can see the holes in the ground plane even better. See? Everywhere under these pads, SATA pads, and the components and around the vias.